Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our eighth lecture of the fall 2014 season. I'm Billy Spitzer from the Aquarium. I'm VP of Planning Programs and Exhibits here. And I'd like to thank you all for coming and hope you all enjoy this lecture and want to come back for more. I'm sure many of you are regulars, some of our very familiar faces. Our next lecture after this one is on Thursday, December 4th. On farm seaweed, the next great sustainable seafood, by our very own Matt Thompson, who leads aquaculture work here in our conservation department, and also was winner of our 2013 Cunningham Award. I'd like to thank the Lowell Institute for their generous support that allows us to offer these programs free of charge to the public, and we're very grateful to have their support year after year. And also a special thank you to the WGBH Forum Network for filming this lecture tonight and making it available afterwards to share for those who aren't here and for those of you who want to see it again. I'd also like to acknowledge the chair of our Aquarium Board of Trustees, Donna Hazard, who's here with us tonight.
Hi, everybody.
Just waving up there in the front. And tonight, I have the honor of introducing our speaker, Dr. Scott Kraus, who I worked with here for many years. Scott is the Vice President of Research here at the Aquarium, and he has been a research scientist in the Aquarium's Research Laboratory since 1980. Scott received his bachelor's degree from the College of the Atlantic, his master's in science and biology from University of Massachusetts, and a PhD from University of New Hampshire. And he has been conducting pioneering research on whales since 1980, back then, and has published many, many, many papers on marine mammal biology and conservation. He currently serves on the U.S. Large Whale Take Reduction Team and the Scientific Advisory Board for the Massachusetts Ocean Plan. He's also the co-author of the book, The Urban Whale, which summarizes many decades of research on the endangered North Atlantic right whale. And Scott's recent work is focused on finding ways to reduce the entanglement of whales and fishing gear and on finding solutions to the many challenges that are faced by endangered species in an increasingly urbanized ocean. Please welcome Dr. Scott Kraus.
So I know you're sitting here and you're looking at this gray, blurry, black and white photo and you think this isn't going to go well in the modern age of PowerPoint and digital photography. This looks bad. But I'm going to start, can you hear me okay? Okay, I'm going to start with a little digression. We're going to go back in time and space to a land far away, namely Newfoundland in Canada. And I'm going to tell you a story, which is pretty unbelievable, but it's true, and it's about the only humpback whale that's ever been held in captivity, and her contributions to science before she was released. And in order to understand this, I'm going to give you the background and the context. In the early and mid-1970s, the fishermen of Newfoundland developed a fishing method called cod traps. And what they were is very large boxes of netting that sat in about 40 to 60 feet of water and were anchored to shore by a long line of net. And at the time, there were massive shoals of capelin, a small schooling fish, that would swim along the coastline for spawning purposes every June. And they were followed by also very large schools of cod. You remember cod, they don't have them in Newfoundland anymore, and pretty soon we won't have them here, but they were once a major food staple in the Maritimes. Anyways, the cod would be chasing the capelin. The capelin would hit the net, run offshore and into the box. I mean, the cod would run offshore and into the box, and I saw some of these cod traps, they're about 100 feet on a side, catch over 50,000 pounds of cod in a single day. And there was another predator following the capelin, and that was humpback whales. Now, the humpbacks did exactly the same thing that the cod did. They would run along the shore chasing capelin, and sometimes you would have humpback whales literally coming out of the water, their mouths open. You could stand on those cliffs and jump into the mouth if you wanted to. It was that close to shore, because they would drive the capelin right up against the cliffs. Now, The thing about this is that when the whales were chasing the capelin, they would run up against the shore, they would hit those nets, and they would panic, and they would head directly offshore, and they would run directly into the box of the cod trap. So now you got a whale instead of a bunch of codfish. and they got entangled up pretty good. And the big question that everybody was puzzling about at the time was, why don't they see the nets and the ropes and all this stuff and just avoid it? Because more than a decade earlier, in the late 50s and early 60s, scientists had proven that dolphins had echolocation. They could see like bats in the dark with no vision. They could put a ping out, they would get an image back, they could tell what was in front of them. And it was an incredible discovery that most of the toothed whales had this echolocation capability. And almost everyone at the time who studied marine mammals, there weren't very many, assumed that the large whales also had echolocation. So an acoustician named Peter Beamish, who was working at Dalhousie University in Halifax, decided that he was going to test this. And he assembled a team of biologists and engineers to go to Newfoundland and put whales through some tests. And he was taking advantage of the fact that the whales were getting caught in these nets, and they were therefore stabilized for extended periods. Because the water was shallow, they tended to be at the surface. And so it was a good captive situation, insofar as you could call an entangled whale captive. But in order to get the cooperation of the fishermen, we had to agree to release the whale. So in 1975 and 76, we spent 2 years racing around all over Newfoundland. It was basically a hotline for entanglements, racing around, disentangling whales, and trying all kinds of things. We had hydrophones in every corner of the nets, and we were listening and recording and trying to stimulate some kind of auditory activity on the part of the humpback. Now you're thinking, well, of course, humpbacks, they sing. Everybody knows about humpback whale song. We sent the song into outer space, right? They've been made into movies. They sing. Well, not in the summer, not so much. And what happened was we spent 2 years doing this, and we probably disentangled 30 different humpback whales, and we threw hydrophones in the water for every one of them, and we listened, and we listened, and we listened. We never heard a thing, nothing, not a single peep. So Peter Beamish decided we needed to do a more controlled experiment. You're going to have to put up with a few more great pictures, but this is the place where the experiment took place, and it's in a little fishing village called Bonavista and Elliston on the Bonavista Peninsula on the north shore of Newfoundland, and that's a Department of Fisheries and Oceans boat who spent most of the time with us trying to figure out what we were doing, not realizing, of course, that we were trying to figure out what we were doing. But Peter's idea was that we would replicate the studies that were done on dolphins 10 years earlier. And that meant we needed a maze, because we were going to run the whale through the maze under different conditions where it would have to either echolocate or not echolocate. And the maze, this is a page from my notebook at the time, and the maze had openings in the walls. Let me see if I can. So there's an opening there, and there's an opening there. And these were randomized and moved around over time. The walls are consisted of strings of buoys and pipes that are acoustically opaque, but if the whale ran into them, they would part and the whale could swim through it. So there was no chance of entanglement, and there was no chance of there was no doubt that the whale would see it as an opaque. If it used echolocation, it would see it as an opaque wall. By the way, how did you keep the whale in captivity, right?
Well, there was this little rope, and it went back to a winch.
And it was very interesting. The whale was then, in the initial stages, the whale was winched into the, by hand, winched into the maze before it was released, and but after we started by tugging the whale's tail, I know this sounds like it's out of science fiction, but this is true. Tug the whale's tail twice, and after the first day, if you tug the whale's tail twice, it would swim backwards because they were able to do that. Now you don't see whales doing that in the wild, but they could learn it. So I don't know if that helps anybody, but so. The walls of the maze were acoustically solid, but physically transparent. Whale could go through them. This is the maze in the water, and sure enough, in early July of 1975, a young humpback whale was caught in a cod trap about a mile away from this site. Our team released it and then moved it over to this maze, and we spent the next 3 weeks doing these experiments. And I want you to remember here something about humpback whales. In order to test the acoustic capabilities of any animal like this, you have to blindfold it. It's not so trivial.
If you look at the eyeball of a humpback, the lower lip is going down like this under the eyeball, and the eye is right there. And
you couldn't exactly put a pair of shades on it, you know, really dark sunglasses. And you had to figure out some other method. And so this was another drawing out of one of my notebooks, and this is the point at which my parents were beginning to wonder what exactly they paid that college education for. So here's the edge of the mouth. This is the description of what the whale, this is basically what the whale looks like in real time. And in order to get these measurements correctly, basically I spent several days in the water with a tape measure like some insane tailor. As the whale came to the surface, I'd swim up to it and measure some part and then yell out a size and distance and all that. And that went on for a little while. The whale's not too keen on that. But at the end of it, we made this, and this is from the scientific literature. This is the eye cups that were used for the eye patches. And basically there were three toilet bowl plungers. Toilet bowl plungers are incredibly useful in whale biology. And there were three of them in this kind of configuration with foam around it so that you wouldn't touch the eyeball. And away we went. So the idea was that when you got to these situations, you had the whale in the maze, you had divers in the water on both sides. When the whale came to the surface, the divers would swim up to the whale, put the eye patches on. Very exciting moment. And then the whale would be let go, and the whale would swim off through the maze. And it's amazing because it actually worked. Now, there's one little feature about these whales that you probably don't know, and I just want to point it out here, is that this is a mom and calf from Hawaii, but if you look down the jawline here, the eyeball of a humpback whale sticks out about 6 inches on the sides of the head. So in fact, when they rotate their eyes forward, there's quite a bit of forward visibility, more than you think. In fact, enough so that you don't want to get yourself in front of a humpback whale in captivity too close. Now, the results of this are interesting because we did 33 trials, and 22 of them were in daytime and 11 were at night. Of the 33, 13 times it was gone through blindfolded, and every one of those failed the maze. In the nighttime, or in the 20 trials that were with no blindfolds, 13 showed visual avoidance, and 7 of them showed no avoidance whatsoever, ran into the maze. All of those were at night when the visibility was poor. I will say the numbers don't quite add up, because in the early nighttime trials, we actually attached a little flashlight to the tail, thinking, oh, it'll be easier to see where the whale's going. What in fact happened was that little bit of light was enough for the whale to see where it was going, and it went through all the maze perfectly. So we took the flashlight out and then just used, let ourselves get used to the nighttime vision. So. All right, so that's then, and this is now. In recent years, I've been working on the North Atlantic right whale, and this animal is in one of the most endangered whales in the world. There are about 500 of them left in the North Atlantic, and the reason that they're endangered is because they were hunted quite extensively for over almost 1,000 years, and they nearly reached extinction by the late 1800s. Now, they have been recovering, but quite slowly, much slower than all other right whales. And there are other right whales and other right whale populations in the world, and all of them are recovering at about 7% per year. But the North Atlantic right whale is only recovering about 2%. And part of the reason for that is that they get killed by collisions with ships and entanglements in fishing gear. And the entanglement problem is actually growing in magnitude, as I'll show you in a minute. They get caught in fixed gear, not movable gear, not mobile gear. So it's lobster pots, crab pots, gill nets, and long lines are probably the major problem. And over 80%, about 83%, I think, of the population that is alive today has scars that indicate they've been entangled at some time in their life. So this entanglement problem is very widespread. Most whales are able to free themselves, but we're killing between 1 to 5 right whales per year in fishing gear. This problem is increasing, and we are, and this is in spite of a federal take reduction plan that's been in place now for almost 20 years, and in spite of numerous federal regulations to reduce entanglements and reduce the lethality of entanglements. So anyways, this is a problem, and it's continuing to grow. Right now, what we do for entanglements is pretty lame. I mean, it's heroic, but also not very effective. Basically, no fisherman wants to catch one of these whales, and I can't say that the whales are very fond of it either. So right now, our only solution to entanglements is a method where humans in small boats race up behind the whale and then spend a lot of time trying to cut the ropes off the whale without getting killed. And there is some risk to this, and the problem is that only about 20% of all entanglements that are severe like this are detected. So there's at least 80% of these entanglements go undetected, and the whales are still swimming around with the ropes. So everyone, including the fishermen, agree that prevention is the answer. And about 10 years ago, at a Maine fishermen's forum, a fisherman came up to me and asked the same question that they asked in Newfoundland 40 years ago. Why don't the whales see the ropes and avoid them? And it remained a really good question. So I got to thinking about right whales and the fact that the original humpback question remained unanswered. And if we assume that there is no biological sonar, if we assume that that experiment is valid for all the baleen whales, and it appears to be, then they must use eyesight for near field avoidance. Now, eyesight underwater is not so great in the North Atlantic. You rarely get more than 40 feet of visibility. So it's an interesting conundrum. There are probably other navigation methods, but the eyesight piece is probably good for near field avoidance. So I have to do a little bit of eyesight lesson. This is the part where you can fall asleep. So the typical mammalian eye is familiar to most of us. It's, you know, you got the cornea, pupil, and lens, which help focus the image, and then the retina collects the image on the back of your eyeball. And the retina has rods and cones, and the rods are generally used for low light visibility. They're highly sensitive to low light, but not very good for visual acuity. And the cones are better for bright lights, but they're also really good for high resolution vision. A single rod looks like sort of like this. And it's basically a regular cell with all the regular cell parts. You remember this from high school biology, right? Right? And except for the back end, which has got these really interesting series of discs with photoreceptive molecules full of light-sensitive pigments. And this is a really cool little trick of evolution, because both the rods and cones have specific pigments which are sensitive to different frequencies of light, which means they're sensitive to different colors. So this, and humans, we're lucky for the most part. There's a number of us who are partly colorblind or completely colorblind, but most people have a pretty good sensitivity to a variety of colors. And that's because we have a variety of pigments. These are the nanometer frequencies of the color. And the only reason I put these up here is so you can see these numbers correspond with this color. So this is 414 nanometers wavelength in light. And this is 500 right in here. And these pigments allow us to see this full range of the color spectrum. Now, most animals don't have the same diversity of pigments. And in this case, I'm showing you the color sensitivity data for 3 different whale species and a cow. The cow is on the right, number 4, the Taurus. And the other 3 are, this is a beaked whale, it's a bottlenose dolphin at 2, and the right whale is at 3. And the peak is about 493 nanometers. So that's in the blue-green spectrum, and in fact, all those whales are, and that makes a lot of sense. And here's why. In the open ocean, red light doesn't transmit very far. This is 50 meters at the max. Green light goes farther, but blue-green is actually reaches the farthest into the ocean. Light penetration of all colors is less in the coastal zone because of freshwater runoff and eutrophication and plankton development and all kinds of stuff, just limits visibility. So anyways, right whales are down in this color spectrum, down in the blue-green section. So maybe in thinking about the way back to the entanglement problem, I got to thinking, well, maybe these whales can't see the ropes because they disappear in the dark or they disappear in the background color. What if we could make ropes that had a high contrast against the ocean backlight? So I designed an experiment to do exactly that, test exactly that question. And of course, I still didn't know what right whales could see. And we didn't have any information about it. I contacted a colleague of mine named Jeff Fasick, who works down in Florida, and was trying to figure out how right whales find food by using molecular attributes of right whale vision in his laboratory. And that meant he was looking at the opsins, or the pigment, the genes that coded for the pigments in the back end of the retina. And I will talk a little bit more about his findings shortly, but in the meantime, I didn't have that data, so I decided to try several different colors and see if I could figure out a way to challenge right whales. And this is how we did it. So this experiment took place over 3 years in Cape Cod Bay. The idea was we would set out fake ropes in front of these whales. And the whales in Cape Cod Bay are skim feeding. So they're at the surface all the time, which means from an experimental point of view, it allows us to see when the whale changes direction or changes behavior as it's swimming around at the surface. And because they stay at the surface, it's almost the only place you could test this. So what we did is we laid out a line of fake ropes. The colors were randomized, and then we would stop the boat up here, and then the whales, we would hope, and once in a while we got it right, but we would hope the whales would be swimming in a certain direction, we'd keep going in that direction, and then they would encounter the ropes and we could look at what happened to them. The whales and the buoys were tracked with a laser rangefinder, so we know precisely where they were and what the distances between both the whale and the buoy was at all times. And all buoy and whale positions were recorded on a mapping grid for analysis. The design is more or less shown here. I mean, you can see the idea, and it looks good on paper. It wasn't quite so good in real life. But the PVC rope extends down about 6 meters underwater, and the skim feeding whale encountered something with a lobster pot on top. So it looked about as realistic as a surface rope would look. Now, building fake ropes is not so easy. So, because they had to have certain characteristics. We had to be able to deploy them quickly, and they needed to be any color I wanted to test. And they had to be designed so that if a whale ran into one, it wouldn't get entangled or injured. I ended up using PVC pipe because it was cheap and it takes paint easily, so you can paint it and paint it any color you wanted. And I ended up scoring it every 2 inches so that if a whale did hit one, it would break and the whale would be able to swim through it. And the other great reason is that I had a lot of staff who didn't know they were going to be victimized and have to wear respirators to paint the ropes for days on end. So the fake ropes were painted in colors that are currently common in fisheries, the black and the green. And then we painted others in red, orange, and white. The orange is not shown here. And I want to say one thing about the, you always have to mistrust your own instincts. I had thought, you know, it's dark in the ocean. Well, we put a white rope out, that'll be really good because it'll show up, right? So, and then we discovered a way to make rope glow in the dark, which would even be better. So now I had this glow-in-the-dark rope that was white in the daytime and glowed nice green at night. And that's that rope there. And I thought, geez, well, this is like the cat's meow. So anyways, the problem with this is that the colors and contrast of what we think of as color under change underwater. and not in ways that a terrestrial mammal might expect. I'm the terrestrial mammal. We took underwater readings on visibility, which ranged around 15 to 25 feet during the experiment, with local patches of diminished visibility of like sometimes as low as 12 or 15 feet. We also filmed the ropes underwater to see what the ropes looked like to the human eye. So from left to right, it's white, green, black, red, orange, red. We used a couple different colors of red. So that all looks very interesting with one notice that's kind of faint. That's the white rope. It seemed like a good idea at the time. So now about this time, Jeff Fasig comes back from the laboratory with some very bad news. Right whales don't have any cones. It might be the only mammal in the world that does not. They're rod monochromats. They see in black and white, but not in black and white the way you and I think about black and white. Remember that their peak sensitivity is in the blue-green, so it's 493 nanometers, and that blue-green creates a blue-green space light, which to the whale appears white. And that means that things that don't show up or show up well against that blue-green space light will be higher contrast. And I filtered this image to show you what we think a whale sees. And this is the orange rope, and you can see that this is actually pretty high contrast. The red, not so much, but this was a particular type of red that we used some more of it, but not so much. The black and the green were okay, or the black was okay, and the green was not so good, but the white pretty much disappeared. And this is one of those lessons that made me very glad that I hadn't gone to the fisherman and said, let's try white rope and big numbers. That would have been bad. So, the thing is that because the wavelengths of red and orange light attenuate rapidly underwater, those colors appear to be the highest contrast against the blue-green space light that appears white to the whale. And so in this case, the fluorescent orange rope shows up the best. And we abandoned testing the white ropes after thinking about this a little bit more. But I will say that as an aside, we tried this other harebrained idea, which is to put LED lights on one of these ropes and see if that would help at night. And of course, I think the only thing I need to say about that is that salt water and electricity are not very good companions. So, what did the whales do when they were confronted with these weird ropes that we put in front of them? So we're going to show you, this is actually a relatively nice view of, this is almost a textbook view of our deployment where we had five ropes in a row. The whale is skim feeding, and as soon as it lowers its head, it's out of detection. This is a red rope. Now it turns away from it, but it's going to run right toward this one, which I think is a black rope. There. So another change in behavior, that perhaps the most dramatic, among the most dramatic ones we saw. That was like a textbook response to our rope fields. And I'll show you a couple of other examples. Now this is a whale who had been entangled at least twice before. So you would think that that would teach them something, but apparently it doesn't, probably because they can't see that well. This whale is a number 1080. And what you'll see here is that this whale actually only saw that rope very close to it. It's a green rope. And it's green because you can tell from the green tassel on the top. The whale made the turn as soon as it saw it, but it saw it so close that the flipper, which is about 3 meters long, caught the rope in its armpit, basically, as it was turning, because it turned up like this, and the rope was caught. And you can see that it let go after it made the turn. But the change in behavior, I'll show it to you again, is very subtle. This whale is skim feeding. By the way, this is the top of the schnoz, and the eyeballs are down low. The mouth is open,
And the change in behavior is right now,
when the little splash occurred on the tip of the snout. So it's pretty subtle, but that's the point at which the whale went, oh, there's something in my way. Now this is this, I'm going to show you another film of the same whale approaching a red rope.
Same thing, skimp feeding, same whale, red rope. You can see they're moved around a little bit. The currents in Cape Cod Bay are unpredictable, and so the ropes were not always in a straight line. But it didn't really matter for our purposes, because we could make a pretty good stab at figuring out getting it in the right area. So this whale made a turn. It actually lowered its snout a little earlier, made a turn. And because it, we think because it was red, it actually was able to see
long enough in advance to make a turn so that its flipper cleared the rope. Okay, the experimental results were pretty straightforward. We had 154 events. We had to eliminate a bunch because either the whale was submerged at the time, you couldn't tell what the change in behavior was, or there was interference from another whale swimming into the arena and disturbing that whale, or the distance between the whale and the fake rope was more than 10 meters, and we didn't have any evidence that the visibility underwater was good enough for the whale to see it. But anyways, we got 70 with a detectable reaction, 15 without, and we have 17 records of whales hitting these ropes. The closest eye distance at which we saw a change of behavior was measured for every one of these events. And what you'll see here is that if you were bright orange, the distance, the mean distance of a change in behavior was a little over 4 meters. It was a little less than 4 meters for red. It was about 3 meters for black, but it was less than 2 meters for green, showing a pretty clear difference in responses, the distance of their ability to detect it. I will say that there's something funny about this number. Even though the number is high, there's a huge variance around this, which means that the range of measurements is very large. And we wanted to know why that was, and it turns out when you analyze it by time of day, this is what's going on. Early in the day, when the light is low, you don't have really good visibility underwater, and the whale detection distances were much lower. In the middle of the day, they were up around 6 meters or more. And then later in the day, they started to tail off as the light went down. So this response apparently is dependent upon ambient light and how much light is penetrating the water. The least amount penetrates at low angles to the sun. Are they significant? Does it matter? Well, it turns out that the differences between red, orange, and both red and orange and the green are highly significant, and it's barely less than significant between black and green. And the collisions with ropes actually show the same thing. We had 8 collisions with green ropes, 4 with black, and only 2 and 3 with red and orange. So it looked like there really was a difference throughout these different color schemes. And so we thought, well, let's have a look at the real world. What color are the ropes that are taken off whales by disentanglers? And one thing that I need to point out to this is not effort corrected. So we don't know how many fishermen fish green rope or gray rope or white rope or black or blue rope. But at the end of the day, when you look at this data, the majority, more than 50%, are of the ropes that were taken off, whether they're white, gray, or light green and blue, the colors that disappeared most rapidly when we looked at it as if we were a whale. So I want to go back to Jeff a little bit, because he started out looking to try to figure out how right whales found food. And he looked at the color of their primary prey. Now this is a Calanus finmarchicus. It's a small copepod about the size of a grain of rice. And as you can see, this has a lot of red pigment. And this pigment actually varies from season to season. Sometimes in late summer, this entire animal will be red, filled with red oil. And so this is a general color that we think this animal displays underwater. Now, remember that red doesn't transmit very well or emit very well underwater. So from a whale's point of view, This is what it would look like to us underwater. Remember that the whale has this limited monochromatic vision, and the spectrum of calanoid copepods, that part that comes out red, is way off in the 500s, so that it's not at all, shouldn't at all be visible in terms of the color. But in terms of contrast, this is extremely bright. And the National Geographic funded a research study on blue whales, and they used the critter cam to look at what a blue whale was seeing. And this is what it looks like to the blue whale. So if we use this same notion, and we believe that the color pigments that are red show up as a really high contrast cloud in the water, you can see what the blue whale is looking at. There's a cloud there that shows up black against the white space light, another one there. It's diffusing here a little bit, but even here you can see these little speckles that indicate
the red pigment against the white space light.
So, so the whale's eye seems to be tuned to see this planktonic prey as high contrast clouds against the blue-green background light. Now let's go back to the eyeball of the right whale a little bit and look at a couple other things about it. A right whale eyeball is about the size of a grapefruit, and it has the same kind of bulge that a humpback whale eye does. So you can see they have slight forward visibility, but probably not directly in front of them. If you look at this picture in the lower right, this is a drawing by Scott Landry next to a 30-foot boat that's the research vessel of the aquarium. And so she's about 42 feet. And the eyeball of the right whale is down here. The lower jaw is like that. And when you were looking at the skim-feeding whale, that whole lower jaw is dropped like this, and their mouth is open. They're just skimming copepods through that baleen, and they just swim around for hours like that. But the distance between this and the tip of the snout is 3 to 4 meters, closer to 4. So imagine swimming around with this limited visibility, say in 15 feet of visibility. You are only going to see something 15 feet in front of you, and your head is already right there. You don't have a lot of time to change direction. So they have very little notice of the danger that may appear in the form of ropes. And I'm going to show you a collision that helps us understand why and how right whales get entangled. So here's the collision. This whale runs right into the middle of that rope, turns sharply because it's freaked out, and pulls away, and the rope gets caught on the flipper and breaks. I'll show it to you again. Whale skimming. There is another whale behind there. Pay no attention to him. Makes the turn, catches the rope. Now, if this were a real rope, let's imagine what happens. The whale turns, flips up, the rope wraps over here, and starts falling back like that. And the whale returns to this position now. The whale has either got a rope over its back and around its tail, or around that flipper up tight. And you can see that this is the beginning of a situation where animals can get entangled quite severely. In some cases, we have very few observations of entanglements occurring. When we do, it looks like what whales do is roll. When they get rope on them, they don't like it, and they roll. So in a situation like that, if the whale keeps rolling like that, it's just going to wrap itself up. And the only other behavior that's really been seen frequently like that is when gray whales get into the California kelp forests and they get wrapped up in that. They spin their way out of it. So it's probably some evolutionary pattern of behavior that works in cases of kelp forests. Doesn't work so good in fishing gear. Okay, so at the end of the day, we think that there's a very good chance that orange and red ropes are a possible solution to some part of the entanglement problem. We don't know. We know that it's underwater visibility dependent. In low visibility situations, you're not likely to have the effect that we saw. We don't know what the resolution in a whale's eye is. Since they're rod monochromats, it's very likely that their acuity is not so good, that maybe they have visibility or vision that is a bit like my first photographs, you know, kind of grainy and black and white. It may not be as effective in the depth, but one possible hope is that these are very large eyeballs. And if the back of the retina is completely filled with rods, it's almost certain that it's been adapted to very low light conditions. So they may very well be able to see down 300, 400 meters and also be able to see in the dark. We think that eliminating green ropes would probably be a really good strategy in the fishery, because that would at least eliminate the worst of the offenders. There is a little note, side note on this, which is that the disentanglement teams that work on chasing these whales down and trying to get them out of ropes don't like black rope, because black rope on black skin of a whale is nearly invisible. They can't tell how the wrap occurs and where it is. So getting rid of black and green ropes, because black ropes are not as effective as the orange and red. So getting rid of green and black ropes might be very helpful, both for disentanglement and for reducing entanglements. So there are still a bunch of unknowns. We don't know how well they see in the dark, but we have hopes for that, and there's some laboratory work going on in that direction. We have no idea whether these findings extend to other species. It's possible that other baleen whales have perfectly good color vision like us with multiple colors, but that's another area where we can do laboratory studies to determine something about that. One of the things that's really fun about this is that this is really a good story about the progress of our science. Almost 40 years ago, we discovered something about whale eyesight while looking for something about acoustics, trying to figure out how they found their way around, assuming that there was echolocation. And then we discovered something about whale vision while trying to figure out how they find food, and it was all laboratory based. And then trying to figure out something about entanglements, we are edging into some understanding about how they see and how they perceive their world underwater. And it's interesting because it's taken acousticians, physiologists, engineers, laboratory techs, and marine mammal biologists almost four decades to get to this point. And although I still don't know what whales see, I do think that this kind of work is really making a significant impact, will have a significant impact on their future survival. Thank you very much. And I'd be happy to take questions. Other than, what were you thinking? Yeah. So the state of Massachusetts does ban lobster fishing during the season that right whales are in Cape Cod Bay. They don't allow any lobster fishing at all. And they don't allow wet storage either. So theoretically, there shouldn't be any gear in the water from Provincetown to Plymouth. Now, the problem with whales is that they don't read the books and they tend to move around. So one year we had all of our right whales were over in Provincetown, and the next year they were all over in Plymouth. And in fact, while they were in Plymouth, they were also extending as far north as Scituate, and there was no regulations with regard to fishing gear up there. So we have seen situations in, actually not just here, but in Maine and elsewhere, where whales are swimming among fishing gear. And when we look at the problem, the rate of entanglement is so high, and it's almost impossible for us to tell where they get entangled, that it's really difficult to say, let's stake out this piece of real estate and leave it for the whales alone, because they move in and out of it all the time. One of the reasons that I've been continuing to work on gear modifications is that this spatial time area closure work works in areas like Cape Cod Bay where you have really high concentrations, but for the rest of the year, they're traveling basically in a gauntlet from Cape Cod Bay up to the Bay of Fundy or out to Nova Scotia. All of the entire Gulf of Maine is filled with fishing gear, fixed fishing gear. And I don't know what you would shut down. I can't even imagine where or what you would do. It's a I'm in favor. There have been proposals that we eliminate all vertical lines and let the fishermen figure out how to fish without vertical lines. That's been really popular, let me tell you. So I don't have an answer to that. I don't think that your idea is a good one, but I think your idea is a good one, but I don't think it was passable. So, yeah. In back. Yeah.
I'm just wondering, what's the chance that fish will avoid the corn?
Fish. I've heard of those. Yeah, actually, getting this permit took me 6 years. And one of the questions that held it up was, what are jellyfish going to do in response to the glow-in-the-dark rope? And my response was, and I'm afraid I didn't gain any friends, was, this is why we call it research. But I suspect that for the most part, where these ropes are occurring, you're not dealing with too many midwater fish, and I suspect there wouldn't be a response. We don't know much about fish vision, actually. So, yeah, good study question. Yeah.
How effective do you think sea lions have been in preventing this?
I think they probably reduced entanglement on the order of 20 to 30%. I mean, I think it's been... Anything that gets rope out of the water column is probably a good idea. But you know, what we're talking about here is managing a conflict between an endangered species and a widespread fishery by intuition, because there's no scientific basis for understanding what works and what doesn't. So, challenge. Far right, yeah. Well, except for one fisherman in Maine who said to me, I fish with red ropes and those things turn pink, and I'm not fishing pink ropes. So, other than that, the fishing industry has been really positive about this. And in fact, the Massachusetts Lobstermen's Association, I gave a talk to them, and they like this because it's not a regulatory issue. We built a bunch of orange ropes, and we had the Maine Lobstermen's Association. We had 8 guys up there fish our orange ropes, and they provided us with a report that indicated that they're not any different than what they're fishing now. They're perfectly happy with doing it. So the changeover to this could be non-regulatory. It could be voluntary. People could do it. It wouldn't cost any more. The rope manufacturers can make this stuff. It's all pretty straightforward. You know, it's a little risky. I mean, it probably couldn't hurt to change everything over to orange gear. So, one more. You had a question.
It was actually about implementation. So how did you, once you had this, what seems like a really simple and elegant approach, how did you get the word out? And what
did the option? Well, we haven't. This is just finished. We're writing up the paper now. And I've given talks to the Maine Fishermen's Forum and to the Massachusetts Lobstermen's Association. And in both places, they've been really well received, mostly because the idea is that it is non-regulatory. If we recommend it and we work with fishermen, I bet we'd see a changeover over, you know, most of these guys are fishing gear that lasts 5 years. So it would be a sequential changeover if we can get the fishermen to use it and the rope manufacturers to construct it. And there's probably some tweaking we could do on the pigments they use in the co-extrusion, in the rope, to make sure that it doesn't fade to pink. But that's just chemistry. We can deal with that. So, yeah. I've heard of you.
How are you?
I'm good. And she invited me to give a talk, and it was very well received, and they did not tar and feather me and run me out of town on a rail.
I just wanted to comment. A lot of the fishermen are converting over to
No kidding.
Yes, they are willingly, as they're...
Woo-hoo!
People, we don't want people to think fishermen aren't conservationists. They
yeah.
are. They're doing everything they can.
Yeah.
And as you're well aware, there was a closure in Massachusetts
yeah.
effective early 2015 to Cape Cod Bay and the Outer Cape area because of the right whale.
Right.
Is it an inconvenience? Yes. Are the fishermen not happy? Yes, they're not happy. But, you know, they know what they have to do. And it's nice to see everyone in the room tonight listening. And, you know, if you want to support your local fishermen, buy your seafood locally.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I've been very impressed, both in Massachusetts and in Maine, with the receptivity of fishermen to finding a solution. That hasn't been the problem. I mean, I think that mostly we don't know what to do, and no one really does. So a little glimpse of hope like this goes a long way, and I think it's great if they're switching over to red and orange rope. It's sort of a giant experiment without any controls, but it cannot do anything but improve what we've got now. So.
And just one thing, on the vertical lineless fishery potential, it's not going to happen.
I beg your pardon? I can't hear you.
I had Senator Markey's office clarify, because then the new rule came out, said no fishing, and if it was to reduce vertical lines, we were questioning why are they saying no fishing. And it's a safety factor for
the oh, right.
And it's a gear conflict nightmare.
Right.
So
no, there's a lot of reasons.
There are fishermen that would fish without vertical lines,
yeah.
but NIMS said no.
Yeah. There are fisheries around the world, just so you know, there are fisheries that fish without vertical lines. In Australia, there's quite an active one, but the fishery is tiny. It's 40 guys,
right.
and so it's not at all comparable.
They
so.
Fish in Boston Harbor with no vertical lines.
Oh, sorry. They couldn't hear you, and I. What would you like to hear? Oh, she said the vertical lines are a non-starter. Yeah, it's basically been eliminated by the agency that regulates it for a variety of reasons. For one thing, they can't monitor anything, and it's a safety issue and a bunch of other stuff. So, yes.
To your knowledge, has there been any thought to standardizing the type or color of rope by location so that you could, when you see an entangled whale, maybe you at least know where the entanglement occurred? Maybe there's some sort of hot spot?
I know just the team that you could join. So she said, she asked about whether we could color ropes in ways that we knew where the entanglements occur. And this has been a topic for discussion in the Atlantic Large Whale Take Reduction Team for almost 20 years. And it's been resisted for a variety of reasons. For one thing, there's no regulations in Canada, so you don't know what color ropes they're using. There's no unified system of understanding who's using rope where. Many fishermen use rope in different contexts at different times a year, and it would require a big changeover in the way the fishery works. Now, the new regulations do require marking vertical lines, but not by region. It's by what part of the gear. And so we're going to learn more in the next few years. But if we were able to tailor make colored rope for each, like Maine lobster fishing, they have 7 zones. You know, if you had one for each zone, you would learn a lot. But what you might learn is that, and it's reasonable for the lobstermen in Maine to argue this, is that, oh, it's some Canadian fishing the same color rope I'm using. And you couldn't tell the difference. So that's a problem. There's not a unified marking scheme. So, yeah.
How long did you have the whale in captivity?
30 days. 29 days, yeah.
How were you able to keep it in captivity?
There was a very large hawser wrapped around its tail. Yeah, we let it out at night. There was about 600 yards of rope, and it would swim out. And we actually saw it feeding on capelin, but it couldn't go very far. And this was pre, you know. No. This was you couldn't even suggest this now. Yes. So there are, there's been a big trial in Australia on humpbacks using pingers. and they looked at trying to divert them away from a migratory route and found no evidence that they worked whatsoever. Now, there's also a non-trial going on in Alaska right now where some longliners and fixed gear fishermen who've been having a humpback entanglement problem are putting pingers on their ropes. They're low frequency pingers, so they're about 2 to 3 kilohertz, and the whales can probably hear them, and the fishermen claim they're making a difference. But the fact of the matter is there's no controlled experiment up there, and the evidence from Australia suggests that this is more wishful thinking than real science. The other problem that really worries, let's say you put a single pinger on every lobster gear, every bit of lobster gear on the coast of Maine in the summer, the entire coast would be insonified. It'd be like, so no one would be in there. So the concern is habitat exclusion, that you would drive animals away from places they need to go to feed. So we don't advocate that. It's kind of and frankly, it would be wicked expensive. Beth.
I just want to add a couple things.
Speak up.
We're making an app for our fishermen. We're high tech now. We're making an app, and they're getting very versed on it. And it's going to have the whale alert ability so that they can see where the whales are.
Oh, cool.
And when the whales were in Plymouth Harbor, what was it, 2 years
yeah.
ago? Yeah. Let me tell you, my phone was ringing at 7 o'clock.
No, I believe it.
They were off the command at 4 yeah. there. So I come into Situate, and I see guys with boats loaded with traps, and I go right down to the docks, and I'm like, don't go. And they're like, what do you mean? I said, don't go. There's right whales at Plymouth. They're coming. So they didn't. They stayed. And yeah. the guys will turn around and come back in.
Yeah.
They don't want to cause any problems to the whales, let alone shut down their fishery.
Right.
You know, the co-occurrence models we all hear about, yeah. whale world and lobster world.
It only works in real time.
Exist.
Yeah, that's right.
Co-existing.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Oh.
Yeah, the
pay no attention to him.
The best thing that I did for reducing vertical lines for acoustic release is when you send any little bop beep boop, it releases some type of weight or whatnot in your line. The only caveat, the only issue is not knowing where your gear is and not knowing where other
right.
There
are technological solutions, but the agency doesn't like them. They have to do with much more sophisticated electronics on boats, which actually detect traps on the bottom and can record where they are so that different fishermen won't set over the top of one another, and it would probably require much more coordination between the fishermen about the direction of sets and all that stuff. I mean, one could imagine a system for doing ropeless fishing, but at the moment the technology is, I know. Yeah, I mean, well, no, but they would be required to have the same kind of detection system. It would have to be a zoning system combined with a really good cooperation and coordination. It's not likely to happen in the near future, so. Like you mean like it is now?
Exactly.
Yeah. All right. Thank you very much.